Hello to everyone out there listening, and welcome to the first season of our brand new Create podcast. Over the next few weeks, we're going to be exploring the world of the creative industries, the fastest growing industry in the UK today. We're going to be chatting to people within the industry, routes they took to where they are today, and how our education system can keep up with this rapidly growing market. Over the course of the next few weeks, we're going to be speaking with people worldwide and try to see what other countries are doing to achieve the same goal. But before we begin, we would like to pay a special thanks to our sponsors, First Port, for making all of this possible. We look forward to working together over the coming weeks ahead. Welcome to the Create Podcast. Hello to everyone out there, and welcome to this, our final episode of the Create Podcast Season 1. Can you believe it? Before I introduce our guest today, who was our final guest of the series, which I'm really excited about, this person, by the way, but I want to take a minute first to thank all of you for tuning in each week to our latest episode, sharing the episodes on social media, and even getting in touch with us. Each week, we received the nicest comments from some of the listeners, and we're extremely grateful. Last week, I said, get in touch, use the Create Podcast hashtag, and we'll read out some of the comments. So we will honor that promise today. And Marjorie Hunter, thank you for saying really interesting interviews each week. Love the hashtag Create Podcast. Thanks very much, Marjorie. Barb S. said, so much honesty in each of these conversations. Humility is a great thing. Barb, thanks very much. I totally agree. And it's great that you're enjoying this podcast series as well. Julianne Mooney from Ireland said, absolutely brilliant podcast. Thanks very much, Julianne. And Kathy Short, we'll leave you with, said, terrific show. Hashtag Create Podcast is a wonderful way to keep in touch with your fellow musicians and spread hope for future entertainers to come. Bravo. Well, thanks, Kathy, and thanks for everyone for the lovely comments and those that we didn't even read out during the episode. It's extremely flattering to receive it each week. And it's just a small section of the amount and volume of comments that we receive each week after our episode goes live. I'm also delighted to announce that as we wrap up season one, I have been notified that this episode and this podcast series, the Create Podcast, is just below the top 5% of all podcasts listened to. So we are just ahead of the top 5% of all podcasts. I cannot believe it. Thank you so much to everyone who's tuned in each week. We've absolutely loved it. This is the brand new venture. We didn't know what we were getting ourselves into in week one, and here we are now wrapping up season one, and we have loved it. I am delighted to say, I know a lot of comments are coming through wondering if we're going to be doing this again, and I'm delighted to say we will be doing it again. The aim of the podcast is hopefully to entertain the listeners first and foremost, but on a deeper level, we hope to inspire anyone of any age from any background to follow in the footsteps of our guest. The reason I wanted to set up this podcast personally is because I feel that when you enter the world of creativity, sometimes you feel like you're doing it on your own, that nobody has been here and done what you're trying to do. And what I wanted to try and shine a light on was the fact that the opposite is the case, that we are all in this together, and there are so many ways to try and carve out a career in creativity. And if any one person listening to this podcast can follow in the footsteps of our guest and achieve a career in it, well then, as I said before, I feel that is job well done. So as we conclude season one today, we will be launching a season two in late winter, early spring 2021. If you would like to suggest a guest for that season, if you'd like to advertise any of the work that you do on that season, if you own a company or if you know somebody close to you that owns a company and would like to sponsor the season, well, feel free to get in touch. hello@brawtalent.org. We couldn't have done anything this season without the help of our sponsors, First Port. And if you'd like to sponsor season two, please feel free to reach out. We've also got more to come in season two that we didn't have in season one, with the likes of PayPal, where listeners will be able to fund projects that Braw Talent will then run in areas of high levels of deprivation. But more of that to come shortly. Plenty of really, really exciting ideas. But today, I cannot wait to introduce our final guest of the series. He's a very close friend of mine, an extremely interesting man. It is Glasgow composer, pianist, and visual artist, Mr. David Munro. Our guest today is David Munro. To some listeners, David might be most recognized from his role as musical director of Celtic Thunder, which is where we met. But David also has an extensive career as composer, pianist, visual artist, arranger, producer, pretty much one of the most creative people I know. I wanted to talk to David about his career before Celtic Thunder, what brought him into music, and what it was like composing and performing on his album Undiscovered Reflections. And since it's Christmas, I thought we'd conclude the conversation by getting into the mind of the man who orchestrated and arranged the songs from Celtic Thunder's Christmas Voices album and symphony tour. I'll play multiple songs from this album and ask him to give his insights prior to playing them. I'm delighted to welcome David Munro to the Create Podcast. I'm absolutely thrilled to not only be joined today, but to conclude this season one with a very close friend of mine, David Munro. It's an absolute pleasure to have you involved in the Create Podcast.
Thank you, Colm, and it's a pleasure to be both the beginning and the end. Goodbye already.
It's an absolute pleasure to finish with yourself, because you joined the dots of a lot of the projects I've been involved in and also what we're doing here, because Braw Talent itself was created in Clyde Bank in Glasgow, and that tended to be the work where that we started off doing, tended to be very heavily based in Clyde Bank. You yourself are from Clyde Bank. And then the work that I've subsequently been involved in, you know, throughout my life in Celtic Thunder, you're the musical director of Celtic Thunder. So for me, you are the link between a lot of the work that I do. Wow. And it's an absolute pleasure to have you on board to chat about a few of those things. So
my pleasure too. Thank you.
So on that point, David, I mean, if people aren't already familiar, I'm sure a lot of the listeners, if they are listening, are, you know, who are followers of Celtic Thunder, would be aware of the fact that you've been musical director of Celtic Thunder for the last few years. But they mightn't be familiar with the journey that you had before Celtic Thunder, which I thought it would be nice at the start of this discussion just to have a bit of a chat about maybe your early years growing up in Glasgow, growing up in Clyde Bank, you know, what those sort of memories were for you. Were they happy memories? Were they, you know, I know personally from speaking to you that you wear the fact you're from Clyde Bank as a badge of honor. You're very, you know, proud of the area and you talk about it. But what was it like for you growing up as a young child in Glasgow and in Clyde Bank in particular?
Well, I think anyone who grew up in Clyde Bank in the 60s and 70s couldn't avoid having one or two massive industries being in their life. Either John Brown Engineering, which was, of course, the shipbuilding yard that built the Queen Elizabeth II ship, and many others, and Singer's Sewing Machine Factory. So those were two massive employers in the area. So when I grew up there, my father and my grandfather both worked in John Brown Engineering, and all our other friends worked either in John Brown's or Singer's. So it was a very working class. I mean, people say working class. Everyone we knew all related to the same big employers. So it was a hard working place, and music, the arts, they were, I mean, you stuck the television on and you watched whatever was on television. Being involved in the arts as an individual was for other people. We didn't know anything about them. So it was a pity, because I knew plenty of people who worked, because I eventually started to work in John Brown's as well, although it was a more artistic side of things. Okay. I worked in there, and I knew so many creative people, but just in that kind of environment, there was no outlet for that. There was no encouragement for it. So you never really aspired to do anything beyond working for either John Brown's or...
So how did you then take the path that you did end up taking? What brought you into the performance of the music side of things? Was there anyone within the area that you could look at as a bit of a roadmap to follow in their footsteps?
Well, I suppose I got a lot of gratitude to pay to the head of music at my school, and it's a sign of my that from the high hill of my great age I can look back at a flat piece of land that used to be my secondary school. Braidfield High School no longer exists. I think it's a car park or it's some other houses now. But my head of music, a man called Bill Keane, who I'm very happy to say we're still good friends, and I know you know Bill, you know
I
Bill
do.
Through his wife. And
yes, yeah, I worked with Bill. His wife, Morag, yeah.
So his legacy is huge. He was an amazing, he was amazing because he didn't even try. he just was musical, and he introduced music into, I mean, I can remember our school choir singing Verdi's Requiem, which is daunting. And he had the school orchestra play, and he could, but he just did that. He just kind of ploughed on and did that on his own. Now, there's me just thinking, I knew I was musical. You know, I knew I could hear something and just play it. And that was what I could do. But I didn't know how to shape that or do anything with it. So Bill didn't realise I could do that until, it's really annoying, sixth year, because I'd gone down sciences. I was going to become a doctor or a geneticist. That's what I was really looking at. And then... we were doing kind of like end of termish things in sixth year, and he said, can anyone do any party tricks? And I said, oh, I can play the piano. And he said, what are you going to play? I said, oh, I'll play Grieg's Piano Concerto. And he thought I was in it for a laugh, so I just sat down and started playing it. And he was like, where have you been?
You know, so that was only in sixth year when that cab was let out of the bag.
Yeah, but I didn't think of going and pushing it. So that was kind of the first thing. So Bill got onto it then, and it was a few years later that I went into John Brown's in their publications department, and you know, they used to produce all these big manuals for the gas turbines they produced. And then I thought, I'm going to go to music college and go to Glasgow University and get a degree in music. So I contacted Bill, and he actually he gave me some piano lessons and talked me through some of the musical things I should know. So Bill became part of my musical launch way back then. Went to Glasgow University, won loads of prizes, and then joined the music staff at Scottish Ballet almost immediately after that.
I was going to ask about that, because I knew of your involvement with Scottish Ballet, and I knew you had many years involved in ballet before moving to the world of opera. Was there much of a turnaround between your time at Glasgow University before working with Scottish Ballet?
No, it was almost instant. You know, while I was at uni, I was teaching a young lad, one of the piano staff, in the teaching staff at SAMD, his son, I was teaching him his son guitar, and it was his the young lad's mother who worked for Scottish Ballet, who knew of me through her husband. So you know, just I guess it pays to always be nice to everyone you bump into.
And, of course, it's a small world.
There's a job going, and you know, they think you might be all right for it.
So, wow. So what was your role within Scottish Ballet at the beginning?
At the beginning, the role that I went for first was in the education department. Now, playing for dance involves having a stack of tunes in your head. Or if you don't have a tune to fit the occasion, you just make something up. So I was fine with improvising stuff and having a laugh. And then when I couldn't believe when I went in to play for dance, it was like the most perfect thing, because they would say to you things, could you give us something that sounds like Prokofiev, but it's in 5-4 for the dance. So it had to be regular. So I was like, fine, I'll just make something up. And that worked for me. So that was great. So I worked with the dance school that trained the younger dancers, who sometimes went into the company, sometimes went on to other. So I was there for 2 or 3 years. Then I moved into the actual company's headquarters in Glasgow, and just joined the music staff there, and then began to play for the productions there.
So. And I mean, ballet brought you around the world as well, didn't it? You were working with Miami City Ballet, your Singapore Ballet.
Some incredible creative people and incredible experiences. And I still couldn't believe it. You know, I can remember arriving in Malaysia one day in this absolutely luxurious hotel, and I was like, on the plane on the way over, you know, it's the first time I'd done the big 14-hour flights Southeast Asia, and I was just looking at my hands and thinking, I can't believe, you know, because I still had this sort of I should be working in John Brown's or working in heavy industry or something mentality, because I think you have that stamped into you from your background, and that I just couldn't believe it. And then when I got to the hotel, it was like utter luxury. It's the first time I've ever been in a hotel where there was a television hidden in the bathroom wall. So when you were having a bath, this television would just emerge through, I thought it was a mirror, and then all of a sudden the television would just come into focus and be on the flat. this is amazing. I'm just a wee plonker from Clydebank. Here I am.
Yeah, where are the cameras? You're being watched here by someone, yeah.
the king of Malaysia, you know, because I had a letter from the king to get into the country. So when we arrived at the when I arrived, because I came late, the company was already there. And I came out and I got to security and all that, and I didn't know what this letter said. It was written in, it was in Malaysian script, and I handed it to the security, and all of a sudden I was brought out the queue, you know, and offered cups of tea and things like that, and then led to a private area where it was all pushed through very quickly, and there's cars waiting outside. So I mean, that getting around the world, and you know what it's like when we've toured, and it opens up all kinds of things for you. You meet incredible people.
Absolutely, yeah, it's incredible.
You get to do things. Suddenly you're walking through the White House, and you know, all these things that open up to you when you've got a bit of a privileged position. So that was my very much in my head, that juxtaposition between just being a normal person from Clydebank and living this high artistic life, which I really couldn't, but
that's what's amazing about you, David, is that you've got so many areas. I would love to talk all day about music with you, but you've also got sketch work that I should mention, which is outstanding. It's not just music that you're involved in. In fact, it's great that you're joining me now from your living room there, because I remember with the guys in Celtic Thunder, we had many rehearsals there beside your piano, and there's sketches on the wall beside your piano, which somebody one day at one of our rehearsals alluded to the fact that you sketched those. And I remember it was a Laurel and Hardy one that was the sketch in question at that time. And as you're well aware, there's never really a serious conversation when all the guys are together in Celtic Thunder. And I just genuinely dismissed it as if they were having me on until I found out it was true. The work you've done on that front is outstanding. So how did that come about? Or was that something that you were doing from a young age?
I think it was about 20 years ago that I just bought some pencils. I mean, I did art at school, and I knew I could knock out a reasonably close depiction of whatever I was drawing, but I was also always fascinated by the hyper-realists and people who want to achieve a really high finish on the rendering. And so I bought some pencils, and I just sat at home one day and got a photograph and just started sketching it, and then went back and worked at it, and then got it finer and finer, and then thought, oh right, okay. And I was doing things, crude things, like using my finger and trying to blend things. And since then I happened to have become very friendly with one of the world's leading hyper-realists. I think you met him at my house, Dirk Jamirski.
Oh yes, yeah.
Art of the highest order. And he really took me under his wing, and he became a mentor. And it doesn't mean to say I don't work at it. I think one thing that I enjoy from art is that I feel like I have to work at it. And I don't have to work at music. That sounds really immodest, but music comes quite easily to me when I'm working at music. The art thing, I have to get a new set of skills, and I have to learn and apply myself in a way that I don't feel that I have to do with music. So from that point of view, I like having to work, you know.
Do you find, because the worlds can be, although a lot of people would lump them under the same umbrella, that they're quite different worlds to be in and different headspaces to be in, do you feel that if you're involved in one world for long enough that you start missing the other, or does it just come naturally that when you get a bit of a break from music you naturally gravitate towards?
Well, I kind of view them quite separately. Like I said, the music thing is just there all the time. And there was a period about 18 months ago when I found myself doing quite a lot of art, and I found myself becoming that kind of mentality. So I feel like an artist now, that's all I do, you know. And I kind of missed the music side of things. So The art thing, I think I will always feel as though I've got a lot to learn in it, and
sure,
I still have a lot to learn about music, but I've done that a whole lot more. So
yeah,
I feel like a lot of the answers to the questions that I'd sort of give myself. But in the art world, I see there's so many talented artists out there. They've got so many different techniques, and they use so many different, like for me, a piano is a piano. and a great pianist is doing the same thing on the same instrument that another pianist will come along and do something, you know, sort of mediocre. But with artists, there's so many tricks and there's so many different materials that can be used. And when I say tricks, I mean the devices to try and achieve.
Sure. Yes, yeah.
But I mean, I'm not interested in just copying. That's what I think. Even in the art thing, the thing that combines them is my. I love drawing people in, and I love creating something that they can share in or something that they can understand. So for me, just to copy the Laudlin Hardy thing you referred to is just a copy of a drawing, but not a copy of a photograph. Now I like to make, if I'm going to do drawings, and I love drawing hands. So I like the hands to tell a story. And for me, doing images of people's hands as a portrait reveals a whole lot more about the person than the face, because you can make your face up, you can do your hair, you can have a nice, you know, dress on, or a collar and tie. Yeah. I know you like to wear a dress every now and then yourself. No, but you can dress yourself up and look presentable, or you can project something different. Hands don't lie, and to me they just represent work of a human being. And I my plan is to do a whole series of fairly high profile people and just their hands, and then people have to guess who they are through looking at the hands, because I think hands give away quite a lot of information about.
Absolutely. And again, these are the, you know, notions that I certainly wouldn't have had until you pointed it out, and I've seen some of the work you've done in the past, and it's really moving. It's really, you know, emotive to actually see a portrait of someone's hands. It really does tell a full life story.
So that as I said, those are the things that combine my love for what I do with Celtic Thunder, for example. I have a chance to work with top quality musicians, engineers, orchestras, conductors, and of course, top quality frontline singing. So it's a big project. And despite the size and the depth of it, the bottom line is always someone is going to play this track, probably alone, or maybe just with two or three people in the room. And it's got to speak to them. If they're the only people on earth who hear this track, it must do something to them. I'm not content with making a track that is just there to fill an album. Mm. Neither do I like to waste my time doing a drawing that doesn't feel that it can connect humanity in some shape or form. I know that sounds very grand and very lofty, and maybe there are plenty of people who do it better, but I think if there's an intent behind what you do, something of that comes through in the final product, and all you can do have an intention and then leave it out.
Absolutely.
There.
So, it's amazing, and it certainly is worth checking out for sure. Going back to the music front then, David, when you're looking at the career you've had and the different, although we bracket it all as music, you know, you've worked with ballet, you've worked with opera, you've worked in contemporary, you've worked as a musical director, you've worked as a pianist, you've worked as a composer, you know, is there any area that you feel most comfortable in, or are you someone that likes balancing a few different operations, or what's that like for you in your head? Because you always come across from people who work with you, like no matter what your environment is, that you're at home there. But you know, what's it like internally for you?
Well, I mean, it's a really good question, and you are a very good interviewer, because that is a thing which it doesn't bother me. But I do like to have, when I wake up and I've got 20 arrangements to write, I think of myself as an arranger that day. If I have to go into the studio and start producing the album, I'm a producer. If I've got three songs to write, I go away and think as a composer. So, or if I'm a musical director, I'm thinking about what I need to get from the band or from the overall performance. So I find myself being able to switch hats quite easily, and I actually prefer that.
I always feel, David, there's nothing really that you do by half measures, that you're extremely well read in a lot of different fields. You're extremely competent in all the work that you do. And one of the things that I loved talking to you on the bus or, you know, off stage about was creativity as a concept in education, that it was something that you cared deeply about, the idea of creativity and how can we better it? How can younger generations move into that world? And it's a very difficult thing to actually fully implement in a school setting when the outcome is an examiner looking at you telling you if you're right or wrong by what you did.
I think everyone's creative, but a lot of young people who come through the school system are faced with this rigid system of learning stuff and then spewing it out for exams. Now, that really doesn't do it for me, because I don't think you're encouraging the natural abilities that person has. And it doesn't really matter what age you're dealing with, whether it's, you know, you can have be dealing with a 60-year-old person or someone who's 16.
Yeah.
Everybody wants to be creative. Everyone has that urge to reproduce an idea that they've had. And I think we all want to leave a trace. You know, one of the biggest instincts we have is to reproduce another human being. And I think that's where art and humanity combine, because I think people want to leave a trace of themselves and a little bit of, maybe if I don't draw something or take a photograph or think of a thought and write it down in a way that's never been done before. Those are such important things to give people permission to do. And so that is an overarching theme in my life. I enjoy people who are creative naturally, or I love the thrill of seeing people being given the opportunity to do something and embracing it. And I think if our education system taught creativity as much as it teaches English and mathematics, all these things are important, but I think if the thought that let's teach creativity, I think you automatically become a better mathematician, better at English, better with words, better scientist, better politician. It makes everything better. And there are fewer fights as well, because you learn to reason, you learn to have a sense of critical thinking going on, where you can reason with someone else's point of view without resorting to fisticuffs. So I think it's more than education. I think it's more profound than that. It's about treating human beings like they've all got something to say. We don't always have the time to listen to what everyone has to say, but where we can create that opportunity, I think it's a very special thing.
I think the listeners are probably beginning now to realise what I was talking about when I was saying that I absolutely loved picking your brain off stage about any area. I mean,
likewise with you, Colm, I do that to you. I mean, it's not a one-way street.
No, of course. You've
got a unique way of dealing with people and seeing the strengths, and that's something that we've valued over the years as well with yourself. So I think that's why people want to listen to you, because they, do you know what, we live in a world where let's get philosophical again. But we live, I mean, just looking at in the UK there's Brexit, and then around the world there's a pandemic right now. In America there's been an election that's been fraught with all kinds of controversy. Regardless of which side of the political divide you're on. But we live in a world where people just stop listening to other authority figures because they don't believe them anymore. Mm. There's so much doubt of what people say, unless it happens to be your own philosophy that somebody said. But I think we don't trust a lot of people anymore. So when somebody comes along that you trust and you think they're honest, that goes a whole lot into the person who's listening. You go, I don't know what it is, I can't write a book about it, but I know that person's being honest. And that's a virtue that has always been very strong with yourself. And
thank you very much.
Over with that. So, there's not one-way traffic here.
Well, that's very kind of you to say. Thank you. But I think your passions and knowledge in so many fields makes you somebody that others naturally gravitate towards in certain issues. And I suppose that ties us into the world of touring itself. And we met on the show Celtic Thunder, as I mentioned at the beginning of the chat. You came into the show as the musical director. What was that like coming into to a show that had already been touring a few years and assuming the role of musical director?
Well, I think for folks outside seeing someone coming into a role, I think they always feel that it's a big undertaking. It's, you know, there must be massive pressure on you. For me, it felt very organic. It was an evolution of things. I've been touring for maybe a good 15, 20 years before that, but not as consistently and in America as Celtic Thunder is. But I've been doing all of these things. I've been working as an arranger, but in smaller busts. I've been working as a musical director in smaller busts. Celtic Thunder really was the first time I'd done a project which had that long-termness attached to it. Long-termness in everything. Like the first sort of job I took up with Celtic Thunder was to arrange like 36 tracks for orchestra, and we had very little time to do it and to prepare all the singers for all the tracks. And then you go on tour for 3 months. I mean, everything was bigger. And of course, it's America and Canada that you're touring in. So on every level, it was bigger or longer or had more to it. But for me, it felt like I was just doing all the things I normally did. Okay. And it came at a perfect time for me to just be able to take these things on easily and not feel daunted. Of course, there's a sense of you don't want to let a big company down. You don't want to let down the quality of the work that had been done up to then. So, and also the other thing is, and I know we've spoken about this often with Celtic Thunder, that when you're in the front line with a group like Celtic Thunder, it's not me. I'd worked in like music theatre in the past, and of course you're watching talented singer, dancer, actors being told what character to play and how best to play it, and they're trying things out, but they're playing a role. And Celtic Thunder is very exposing for the singers in the sense that you are the character. It's you. It's Colm Keegan that walks on stage. It's Neil Byrne. And people see, and I've often said to you, you have to pull down a mask. You have to pull down a mask very close to your personality, because if you go out there on stage and be yourself, it doesn't take long in a 3 month tour before you're exhausted giving that true self to everyone. Now, for me, I'm now doing arrangements that I think work. So I'm exposing quite a lot of myself, saying, a lot of people might not like this, but this is what I think works for this song. This is what I think works for this individual.
Yeah, for sure. Absolutely. And I suppose that ties in a lot of what you've already mentioned before in this conversation about things like trust and honesty. And, you know, one of my favorite things about working with you was when we were coming up with a new show, and, you know, we would be left to our own devices to come up with different songs that we felt during our solo numbers gave off a bit of our personality. And you would think a lot about different songs that I would feel would work, you know, vocally or, but I secretly loved hearing the suggestions that you had. You know, whenever we'd go in to rehearse, and if you'd throw out any ideas, I always found it, probably because I explicitly trusted your view of who I was as a performer, of who I was vocally and everything that went along with that, that I used to love hearing the suggestions that you would have for us in the show. And I would have absolutely happily gone along with any of the suggestions that you had above any of the pre-notioned ideas that I would have thought about myself. Some of the songs were songs that we would have sung our whole life, you know, be it Danny Boy, Isle of Inish Free, She Moved Through the Fair, you know, really culturally, you know, important songs for Irish music. And I think what we loved about it, and I remember talking about this in the promotional tour before the Mythology tour even happened, you know, upon the release of the show, was that my first impression when hearing the arrangements was that I felt like this was a brand new version of a song that I felt like I'd never heard before. And the music themselves, I think of Carrick Fergus, for example, with Ryan, that you could almost hear the story of that year that he had and the fall that he had and the trouble that he had. And, you know, thankfully he was okay after going into a coma, and then here he was on stage. You could almost hear that full journey in the orchestration of Carrick Fergus as he wrote it. And I don't even know how to enter your thought process in doing that. And I suppose I would like to try and pick at it now, because for the next few minutes, it being our final episode of the podcast, it being the Christmas time, that, you know, to talk about a follow-up album of Mythology, it felt like Mythology was this really fresh sound of Celtic Thunder that I loved being a part of. And the Christmas Voices album that came after that felt like almost like an extenuating arm from the same body that was Mythology. It was almost a festive themed version of Mythology. So I thought we'd have a bit of fun, if you're up for it, David. I thought what we would do, since it's Christmas, since this is an album that I would love to pick your brain on, because I think the arrangements of these songs are absolutely incredible. I loved it the second I heard it, and now I have you sitting here in front of me to ask these following questions too. So I thought we would finish off the last episode of the Create Podcast Season 1 by looking at a few of the Christmas songs from the Christmas Voices album, which you arranged and orchestrated. Just hear those sleigh bells jingling, ring ting a ting a ting. Come on, it's lovely weather for a sleigh ride together with you. Outside the snow is falling and friends are calling you. Come on, it's lovely weather for a sleigh ride together with you. So the first question, I suppose, that I wanted to try and ask is, do you, when you look at a piece of music and you hear the melody, when you hear the version that might exist beforehand, do you actively or consciously try to make this unique, different, a version that people wouldn't have heard before? Or, you know, what would be your starting point about hearing or arranging a piece that would be put onto the show?
I think there are a number of filters that you have as a starting point. And the first filter is it a good song? And I've heard many moderate to bad versions of a good song, and the song's still good. Mm. But I've heard very few really good versions of a bad song. Do you know what I mean? It works very strongly in one direction. So let's decide that we've got nothing but good songs on the table. Now, that's a very subjective thing. Some people might say, I hate that song. How can you say that's a good song? Songs that we as a group all felt strong about, and they had a bit of a track record that they worked, and we knew they worked. The next point is a fusion of two things. It's first is the person who's going to sing it, whether it's a group number or whether it's an individual. And the individual ones get a maybe special attention. But for me, the starting point for the arrangement is the text. So I'm always interested in, what is the story? What are you trying to say during this song? And I'm never content with just repeating the same orchestration from one verse to the next, because the text is different. So
I remember you talking about that before.
Why would I want to make it sound exactly the same? You know, but that's a commercial thing. It's a pop thing. You use the same backdrop and you sing different lyrics over it. Now, that's fine, and I'm not knocking that, but I don't like to do that. I like to look at the text and then work my arrangement from little details in the text. It might just be a psychological thing. Mm. You might not be being explicit. It's not sound effects I'm looking for. It's psychological sound effects, if you want to give it a time.
And then when you talk about the solo numbers, do you have different themes? Like, for example, when I'm often on tour, a question that I've been asked a lot throughout the past is the introduction to Away in a Manger would share the same melodic intervals as the beginning of the song Edge of the Moon. And I'm often asked if that was intentional, if that was like a bit of a theme going into it. And every time I'm asked that, I think, you know, I never asked that to David myself. But
do you know what? I think that's a sort of, if anyone's into film scores, it's a kind of very David Newman type of thing. And I love David Newman. So I think a lot of these things are in your head.
They're pretty subconscious,
Just so such an open set of chords that I love the openness that it usually says something naive. And I think when we talked about Away in a Manger, and it wasn't an insult at all. We spoke about the candor that a child has to sing Away in a Manger, and I felt that you were the only person that could deliver that with that kind of candor. So maybe I got a subliminal idea that those open chords speak of a really open soul. And we spoke about that in The Edge of the Moon. To be the narrator of that tale needed someone who both understood the humanity of the tale and had a degree of empathy for the characters in it. And and carried it off with a real compassion and tenderness. And I think that's the same in a way in a manger, coming from the other point of view. You are being the child, observing the nativity scene, you know. So perhaps that's the connection, but yeah. I'll have to go and analyze the story.
Away in a manger, no crib for a bed, the little Lord Jesus laid down his sweet head. The stars in the bright sky looked down where he lay. The little Lord Jesus asleep on the hay. The cattle are lowing, the baby awakes, but little Lord Jesus, no crying he makes. I love thee, Lord Jesus, look down from the sky and stay by my side until morning is nigh.
Tell you one intro that I know you struggled with, and I'm so sorry I wrote it, was
Gabriel's message.
Gabriel's message.
Do you know?
I'm so sorry. Now we did it again recently. We did it about 3 years ago. We did the Christmas tour, I rewrote it so that it was easier to count. your palm juice of sweat as a heart played through the random number of highlights that you're going, yeah, am I in after this? But no, man, after that, no.
I remember the studio before we even went on tour at the opening number or the opening line of Gabriel's message. I remember my initial thought was, on tour in front of an audience, this is going to be absolute sweating throughout the intro to try and come in. At least in a studio, you can have people in your ears.
As drifted snow, his eyes as flame. All hail, said he, thou lowly maiden Mary, most highly favored lady, Gloria.
I used to love those kind of challenges, and I'm glad you brought up Gabriel's message as well, because I remember going into the orchestral recording sessions to hear them, and you know, the feeling of hearing an orchestra performing a piece of music that you're about to record yourself is just, you know, a feeling I never thought I would have, and certainly one that I'll never forget. And then being up in Amberville Studios putting the vocals on top of that, the first piece we recorded was Gabriel's message, and I remember the next day you guys had obviously been working on getting a rough mix together to show us the track, and I remember standing around with all the guys in the sound booth listening to the rough edit of Gabriel's message, and that is one of my vivid memories whenever I think of Celtic Thunder, whenever I specifically think of this show, this album, having this incredible orchestral arrangement on a piece, standing with people that are as close to you as a family as you can get. You know, obviously people who might not be familiar with Celtic Thunder might not realize that George Donaldson, very shortly after which, sadly passed away. So again, that made the memory even more special. But standing there with the guys listening to this, a feeling you can't really describe.
Was born in Bethlehem.
being able to bring that on tour with the symphony orchestra every night, for me that felt like a lap of honor of something that was really special, that was created back in Ireland, and here was just us. Not the tour wasn't the starting point, that was almost the recognition of the work that you put into it, and you know, that this project that we were all so proud of. It was an amazing tour, you know, without a doubt. I had a lot of happy memories, but that was the happiest for sure.
You're making it sound like it was this wasn't a thanks for the work I put in. I did these arrangements for you guys so that you could go out and perform beautiful music in a way that you would get appreciated for. And I can remember being on tour. That must have been September time, and you mentioned George there. Yeah. I can remember being in Houston, Texas, and the sun was beating down, and the tour buses were outside, and as I say, September wasn't anywhere near Christmas, and I was looking to speak to either yourself or George, and I saw Ryan and said, have you seen Colm? And he said, oh, he's on the bus listening to the Christmas. And you and George were just sitting there with cups of tea in silence, just listening to the Christmas album.
I actually, do you know what? I genuinely remember that. Now you say it. I mean, we listened to it a number of times. But I think that just shows, like, I mean, we were all so proud of it. And I'll never forget that.
That is probably one of my proudest memories. I mean, I think we had a feeling like that after Mythology as well, but after the Christmas album in particular, there was a real sense of pride that I can remember it being one of the happiest times, because I know when people listen to this at home, it's Christmas time and the lights are on and they're planning all the Christmas thing. We recorded this in probably one of the hottest summers I ever experienced in Ireland, and we had a lovely big lawn out the back. We were playing bowls, remember? And when you weren't singing, you were out playing bowling. And
it was the most surreal thing to be standing in flip-flops and shorts and a t-shirt. And
anyone who works in the industry know it's summer, it must be time for a Christmas song. So yeah. But I can remember vividly the laughter that we shared making that album. It was one of the happiest and genuinely funniest times. I think that joy, I talked earlier about an intent, that you just have an intention and people can sense something, and I think that comes through in that album as well. There was a real sense of joy amongst the group, and that, I think that's where the shared pride comes from as well, because we were all in that together.
Contrasting, say, the final verse of Gabriel's Message and how massive that sound was with the full orchestra, and if you compare that to the silence that existed on stage whenever we'd approach a number, say, like Have Yourself a Merry Little Christmas, where it was just the five or six of us around the piano. And I've said in previous weeks in the podcast that for me growing up, I always loved sport outside of music, but it was never an individual sport that I wanted or ever interest me. You know, it was always team sports. It was always football or Gaelic or rugby. And there was something just special about getting to the end of something alongside other people that shared that journey with you. Having that tight harmonies with your closest friends and then getting the applause at the end of it that we all of us on stage worked and off stage, you know, not just those on stage, the whole production team put in their tuppence worth to get that appraisal towards the end. Again, you know, special doesn't do it justice.
It's slightly ironic that you've got 65 symphonic players behind you.
Yeah.
And the highlight is just the a cappella. Just voices. Yeah, just hold my beer, lads. Have a listen to this. No, but I know what you mean, because it was wall-to-wall symphony music, and then all of a sudden the texture changed, and it came right down to that. And I can remember challenging, and David Brophy, the conductor, we were talking about Have Yourself a Merry... There was a pause in it.
Yes, right. I remember that,
and
yeah.
I remember people saying, how long should we hold that pause for?
Yes.
And I remember saying, hold it. See how long you can hold it tonight.
That's right. Because I remember, because I was coming back in with the line, through the years we all will be together. And the challenge was to see how long we could keep that gap before coming back in. And it was brilliant to just hear that silence. And you could almost see the audience from the stage on the edge of their seat waiting for us to come back in with the next line. It was amazing.
And I remember that was always a moment of, nobody was really sure when the next thing was going to happen. And yeah. I think when you're doing something over and over again, it's little moments like that in the song that nobody's quite sure, and it's about instinct, about feeling what your compadres are going to do as well. I think all of that makes it special.
Golden days, happy olden days of yore, faithful friends who are dear to us, gather near to us once more.
My favorite things now about Christmas is being able to, unlike Houston in September, I feel now justified I can listen to the album now that it's Christmas again. So I love putting it on. I really do. But to wrap it up, David, I was absolutely thrilled when you agreed to join us on the podcast. To finish with this, that in recent years you had written your own album as well. I remember when you put that out that you were working on an album, I was like anyone else, I was absolutely delighted you were doing it, but also I couldn't wait to hear what it sounded like. Undiscovered Reflections, what was the process like of creating this music and performing the music yourself?
I find myself trapped in a strange world of pressures, in the sense that if I'm given, I love film music, I love music theater, I love opera, I love theater, and just full stop. I love telling a story through a variety of different means, whether that's through just a singer-songwriter telling you a story, or whether it's full-on acting with lights and costumes and you're buying into someone else's tale, or when you see a film score where the cleverness of writers like Alexander Desplat or David Newman that we mentioned earlier on, John Williams, these guys look at a scene and they go, I know what will set that scene off. Something won't get in the way of it. All of these things have a format, and you're buying in to someone else's, you're collaborating. What I found incredibly difficult was sitting down to write an album of just music. And I struggled with it for a long time. Even though I had ideas, I had thoughts in my head, I had to eventually create scenarios, and that's why I called it Undiscovered Reflections, because they were reflections in my own head which needed to be written down as though they were really scenes in a film, or scenes in a stage play that needed music. And I was writing a soundtrack to that. I find there are composers who compose technically, and they compose beautifully, and they write just the music is everything. It's the beginning, the middle, and the end of their process. The music has to be served and it has to follow all these rules. My way of composing, I felt, was much more like, give me an idea and I'll write something around that idea. So that meant I'm exposing a lot of my inner personal thoughts, which comes up, I guess, another difficulty, another underworked muscle, if you like. If you're not used to doing that, you don't really want to let a lot of these things out as quickly as maybe somebody who's used to doing that. And I found that a very difficult process. I still find it difficult to sort of talk about the tracks and take a lot of credit for them, because when you're doing something with Celtic Thunder, everyone else is doing it for you. And with this, there's no one to blame but myself, or there's no one to take the credit. If it goes the other way, that's fine. But it's amazing, you can hear one criticism and that will live with you. That's the one thing that will live with you longer than all the praise.
It's a reoccurring theme of a lot of people that we've spoken to have said the same thing. And it's a shame in a way that those negative voices speak so loudly. But, you know, for what it's worth, I know I speak on behalf of a lot of people that on the flip side of it, absolutely love the album, you know, couldn't wait for it to come out and loving every second of it.
Thank you very much. I appreciate that.
But David, it's been an absolute pleasure having you on board. Thank you so much for taking the time out. I hope, I know normally there's a get together over Christmas. If we can do it virtually or anything, you know, it'd be great to catch up. But thank you so much for joining me. And it's always great to check in and have a chat. And I really appreciate you taking out the time.
Well, it's been my pleasure. And thank you. You, as I said, great to talk to as ever. And a wonderful interviewer as well.
So thanks, David. You're very good. Thank you very much. I appreciate it. Well, a massive, massive thank you to David for joining us today for our final episode of the Create Podcast Season 1. I hope you've enjoyed the conversation and are feeling a little more festive than you were prior to listening. But just like that, our Season 1 comes to an end. A massive shout out to our previous guests, Doug King, Stuart Murdoch, Nathan Carter, Josie Long, Danny O'Donoghue, Chloe Agnew, Damien McGinty, and of course today, David Munro. A special word of thanks to our sponsors, First Port, for making this possible, and we really, really look forward to seeing you all in the new year for Season 2. Stay tuned, stay in touch, and have a very, very Merry Christmas, and here's to a brighter year ahead. Thanks, folks.